It is a pleasure to have my father, Dr. Delbert Baker, with me to talk about his very important contributions to Black Seventh-day Adventist history. Dr. Baker has been a minister, editor, author, educator, and administrator for 45 years now. So, as I said, it is a joy to speak with him, and we will mainly talk about his work with Black history. Dr. Baker, it's a pleasure to have you.
Good to be here. Thank you.
First, do you want to give us an update of where you are in the world and what you just did for the last 5 years?
Yes. Well, it's a very interesting point in my life at this juncture, because we're just ending a five-year term of service at the Adventist University of Africa in Nairobi, Kenya. And in fact, in a few weeks in December, the middle of December, I will cease or end my time as the vice chancellor or president of AUA, and then I will move into another realm of service. Right now, I'm looking at different options. And so my wife, Susan, and I have had a wonderful time for 5 years serving on the continent of Africa in the nation of the Republic of Kenya. And there we have worked at this institution, AUA, which is a graduate institution. It's the General Conference institution. It's not undergrad, only graduate. So we work with the professionals and the workers of the three divisions on the continent of Africa, three Seventh-day Adventist divisions. That's SID, ECD, and WAD. So we've had a chance to interact with basically the leadership of the continent. And there we have been providing training for these professional Adventist workers primarily, because AUA is probably about 98% Seventh-day Adventist. So it's really been an interesting experience culturally, educationally, professionally, personally. I've always had a love for Africa. I've made 30-some trips to Africa before we got there, working there at AUA. And so to work there for 5 years has really been a privilege and a joy. But now that we're ending it, I'm happy to return home. And we will always have these strong links back to AUA.
Good. All right, can we begin by you telling us how you got interested in the Black Adventist past?
Okay. Well, you asked about AUA a moment ago, and there's gotta be a link there, because my interest in Black Seventh-day Adventist history ties in with my willingness to go serve in Africa for these last 5 years. It's a passion of mine. It's a passion of mine to understand Black history, to understand our role in our saga, our journey as Black people. So my interest in Black SDA history started, 40 plus years ago? I mean, it really started when I was in college at Oakwood University. So this has been a longstanding history, but I think I could best say it by saying that my interests started with an ache. I mean, literally, as a person of color, I always was perplexed as a young man growing up in California. And even though the discrimination and prejudice wasn't so bad in California as it might have been in Alabama or Tennessee or other places, I always had this ache about why was it, or why is it, that Black people always had so many problems and they were treated so difficult and they were discriminated against? I mean, I knew there was equality of races. I had no question about our intelligence and who we were. But the fact that there were always these issues, we were always fighting and battling, you know, it created in my heart an ache. It was a real ache. It was this discomfort. And even the George Floyd situation now and all the racial tensions we see now, while this is overt and blatant, back in the day, I was struggling with that as a young man growing up, just finding my place. And why did we have to have so many problems? And so I think that's where it started. It started with an ache. And I guess that had to do with the pain of discrimination and the pain of having to carry not simply humanity and wanting to make it the world and make a difference, but the burden that race seemed to have with it. And it brought suffering. And even in my young life, I can remember even in California, there were points of discrimination. And I don't want to dramatize it and make it the same way it was with people who, you know, were mistreated in the South, but it's everywhere. So it was that ache. Then there is the early in my life, I always dealt with, you know, curiosities. I was a curious person. I was inquisitive. I would find out why and how and what about this. And that too kind of stroked my my interests or my desire in Black history. I wanted to understand the secret of suffering. Early on, I heard from people who I had a lot of respect for, kind of a paradigm shift in my mind was that don't look upon your Blackness and the sufferings that Black people go through. Don't look upon it as being a burden, but look upon it as being an opportunity for suffering. Because in suffering, there was insight that you could gain in no other way. So I believe that as Black people, we have unique perspectives because of the suffering we go through. And it brings its own unique opportunities. And then I would say heurism, the heuristic aspects of it, the ability that as a Black person, going through the experience that we went through, it provides me and us an opportunity to share. It's a platform in a sense to tell your story. I mean, it's an opportunity. And so my interest in Black history kind of grew up in that whole synergistic kind of flow of thoughts. And finally, I would say my interest in Black history was a result of exploration. What do you mean? What do I mean by that? Exploration. It was a chance to explore. You know, I don't want to be trite, but you know how they say you survive and you thrive. The idea of how is it that we as people of color who have gone through our unique experience of slavery and then Jim Crow and then postmodern challenges we face, how do you not simply survive this period, but how can you thrive in it? How can you make it work for you and for your people? So I think that's my response to what got me into Black history. And I just love it, frankly. So, I mean, I guess all these different reasons I'm giving, you know, are a help to explain it. But the bottom line is I love the topic. I love to talk about it. I love to hear other people talk about it. I'm even quite thrilled the fact that you have an interest in this area and you have done so much groundbreaking work yourself. When I see young men, you know, take this passion and take it to the next level, that just thrills me. I mean, I think it's a wonderful thing. So this is an area that no one person can exhaust. It goes on and on and on.
And you were always in the books. You were always a reader. I remember growing up and your library was literally voluminous. And I would pick up the books, and it's interesting to chart our interests, because let's say you would have 1,000 books in the house. And as I was growing up, I would be interested in different sections of your library. Yeah. Right. And at one time I wouldn't be interested in that section, but then 5 years later, that section would interest me.
Okay.
And so that paralleled my, perhaps a library paralleled my own evolution in history and my intellectual development. But also growing up, I remember that you would have African kings and African people and African American posters on the wall and different things like that.
Yes.
So you were always steeped and interested in history and the intellectual. So
you mentioned something about, you know, pictures and books and everything. That's very true. You might recall that it was in our first pastorate. You were very young, but this was before I took my first trip to Africa. On the wall, we had a huge picture of the continent of Africa. And I remember with Mom, Susan, and myself, I'd tell her my dream was to go to Africa and to take a trip there and to understand, to go back to the roots, so to speak. That was really very popular during that period. And even in the post-roots book period, Alex Kidd's book and so forth. So I had the big picture on the wall, and I remember I used to wake up every morning and look at the map and say, Lord, I want to go to Africa. I want to go there. I just want to be there. I want to get in touch with where I'm from and all this kind of business. And I meant it, and I would pray for that. And I never will forget back in 1976, 77, when this whole thing was developing and growing in my heart and mind to go to Africa. Sometime thereabout, I received a phone call from Zimbabwe in Africa. And they said, is this Pastor Baker? Pastor Baker, they said, we've heard about you and we'd like you to come to an evangelistic meeting in Gweru, Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. And the rest is history. That was my first trip there, and I spent some 3 weeks there doing evangelism in Gweru, right outside of Bulawayo, some distance from Harare there in Zimbabwe. And that was the beginning of my African saga. And so you as sons were all a part of this indirectly. You knew when I was going, you knew my experience, you knew even if it wasn't not at your prime or even your period, you heard about it and you knew it. So yeah, you were raised in that environment of Africa and books. We used to work all kinds of deals with you about reading and getting you involved in it. And even as my parents did with me, so we did with you, our three sons.
And I also want to touch on something that I think is germane.
Oh, man.
The most historians, I would say all historians or people who do history, have some sort of inside or personal reason. And you are a Black Adventist minister. So your historiography focused around people like you, the Black Adventist ministry. You are a historian of Black Adventism. And so it's important to note that you were steeped in the Black Adventist ministry and that you were studying the history of the Black Adventist ministry. That's what you did. So you were studying the history that was very close and personal to you. Please talk about how you first got interested in William Foy.
Well, these pictures on the screen just bring back a flood of memories. I haven't seen these in years and years and years. So this does bring back memories of my early pastoral years, because I first started off 10 years in ministry as a pastor. There I'm looking at Warren, Ohio. I'm looking at Shiloh in Cincinnati, Ohio. Great memories. And really, it was in this period that I'm looking at now, that in my heart or in my mind already were the seeds of the study of William Foy, because I really caught that. Well, I had an interest first, let's say, first in Black history. And so then in my pastorate as a associate pastor in Cincinnati, this was right before going to the seminary or in the process of doing that. And then after that, Warren, Ohio was my first pastorate after that. So during this time, the Black history seeds were there, but it was really at Andrews University when I was working on my Master's of Divinity with concentration in administration and pastoral counseling that I took a class in Christian biographies. It was a simple class. And by the way, when I say this, I hope our listeners and people who see this interview might treasure the simple things of life, little incidents, phone calls, emails, conversation. And in my case, it was a class Christian biographies. I took it. It was the last class I had in my Master's of Divinity program. And so I was wrapping things up. I just figured, let me get this class and just do what I need to do. And my two topics the two persons I had to write on, I chose to write on, were E.E. Cleveland, the evangelist, and William Foy, this Black man who had heard, received visions before Ellen White and who had rejected them. So Cleveland, of course, was something pretty, pretty direct. And I knew him well. I had worked with him in evangelism in Houston, Texas some years before. And so I was pretty much acquainted with him. William Foy, I had read some things about him and I knew there was very little known literature. And so I figured I could just write this, I could kind of summarize this, make a synoptic kind of a presentation on him, and that was it. Well, that was not it, that was the beginning. And the minute I did the Cleveland piece, the minute I began to work on William Foy, I wrote The White Estate. I remember Robert Olson. I wrote him and asked him, please give me all the information you have on William Foy. And I even have the letter to this date. He wrote me back and said, well, there's not much, Brother Baker. He said, there's not much in him. He said, we have, you know, just an interview in 1906. We have maybe a document or two. He said, that's it. There's very little known about him. He said, so I don't think you'll know much about, you'll find much about William Foy. Well, little did he know. He sent me his documents. I worked with Mrs. Jemison, who was in the Ellen G. White Estate office, branch office there at Andrews. And she gave me all the information she had and her husband who had left, just some notes and some observations. But immediately I began to get in that and I realized there were inconsistencies in the stories, inconsistencies in what people recalled about him, what he did and how he did it. But it was a real breakthrough when people had pretty much in the Seventh Adventist Church accepted the fact that this man had received the vision and had rejected it, and he had died in the middle 1840s, around 1845, 1846, give or take something there. When Ellen White said that she had heard him, he had a remarkable testimony, and she simply said that he left, but she said nothing about his death, and this is 1906. So that was the beginning of, wait a minute, there's an inconsistency here. Began to do some preliminary study, and all the studies directed me to know that he lived beyond 1845. Ellen White said he had a genuine experience. And these two, coupled with a lot of loose strands that I began to find, that said this man lived on, but he just wasn't around in the Portland area there. That was the beginning, Ben, and that was the start of it. You see, once a historian operates on questions, yeah, he operates on inconsistencies or what people may think, and then what he has come to see. And then there's some boldness mixed in with it. You kind of believe, okay, you have to have a little courage to say that you're challenging the common perceptions and you're willing to kind of put yourself out there. You may be wrong, but you're willing to put yourself out there and test your theories or your ideas. And that's what happened. And so later, as I went through this and people began to hear about my research and the study, I began to give presentations and I even got with the people at White Estate, and they were very helpful. I mean, the people at the White Estate in Washington, the General Conference, were very helpful. They were not holding me back or not giving me information. They actually encouraged me as well. So I want to make that note. But it was really Calvin Rock at Oakwood College then who heard about my research. And he then said, well, listen, he said, I made a proposal to him, actually. I made a proposal to him and said, I need some funding to back me in doing some research. I want to go to these places. I want to go to Boston. I want to go to East Sullivan, Maine, and other places like that where it's purported that William Foy might have gone. This was evolving. The information was growing as I progressed. And so he gave, I never forget, he gave $2,000, to back, and that was a lot of money back then, to back the research. And he gave me a research committee at Oakwood. And Mervyn Warren was one of the persons on the committee. In fact, I think he chaired it to give me the background and the historical firepower that I needed. He put the history chair and a few other people at Oakwood on this committee, and that was helpful. So then I began my exploration, going up and down the East Coast and Boston area. All the time I was working with confidants, I was working with people at Oakwood, working with Tim Poirier at the White Estate. And what a fascinating journey that was, to go to these places and find original documents. This piece right here, the pamphlet he wrote in 1845, The Christian Experience of William Ellis Foy, together with the two visions. This pamphlet was so heuristic. It allowed me to see so many things I never knew. When you study that thing very carefully, you see the names and you go to the places, you study them out, and you find out these things actually, these people lived, you know where they lived, you saw their names and extant other records. It was a fascinating experience. It was a fascinating experience, but it was also an emotional experience. I want to just give a definite word of affirmation to my wife, Susan, and my sons, who were really patient with me during this period I was studying. I literally put hours and hours of research at home and when I was traveling. And I remember when I came back from a two-week saga on the East Coast, I had a rent a car, I had a tape recorder, and I had just notes, books in that car, and I went from place to place searching out. I remember one of the places I stopped was in Boston, and I stayed with John Nixon. In the period there, just kind of in one of the members of the church there, and they really gave me a lot of support when I was looking at doing this research. But here's what I will say to summarize this saga, which was such a life-changing experience for me as a young Black man. I remember when I got to that two-week research journey, and I went home to where we lived at that time in Ohio, Dayton, Ohio. I was pastoring there. And I went home, and I remember this like it was yesterday. I went to our bedroom, and I was talking to Mom, talking to Susan. And I began to tell her about the experience. I began to tell her about how I went these places and I saw the experience of William Foy. And I had almost been to the point where I began to think like William Foy. It's kind of a strange thing. I mean, you actually begin to understand the man. You begin to feel what he was going through and some of his struggles and how he battled with giving his visions and how he was true to his commission. He did move off the scene in 1845 and became a pastor in another part, in what they call the Eastern Seaboard, New Bedford, and then to East Sullivan, Maine area. And how he, it was kind of a melancholy life in his latter years. I mean, I felt that. He had his moment. He did his part. I like to say that he was like a minor prophet and Ellen White was a major prophet. He did his part, then he passed on to her of the mantle of prophetic, being a prophetic messenger. And he went on to do his business, and he was a real man. She was a real woman. And God used this Black man, then he used the white man, Hazen Foss, different than William Foy. We know that Hazen Foss, in fact, rejected, that's documented. And by Ellen White, said that Foy was genuine and that Foss had rejected the message, and then he gave it to a woman. I always like to feel that God was very much interested in diversity, a Black man, a white man, and a woman.
And in that order.
In that order. And so when I came back and after I had come to these conclusions and I had really started a pretty extensive rough draft of what later was to be the book published in 1987 by the Review and Herald, I was telling Mommy about this trip in Dayton, Ohio. And I broke down and wept. I cried. And it was almost for a moment, I could hardly control myself. I've never had an experience like that before or since. But it was living the struggles. It was entering into the life of this person. and seeing how he was used and how it so reflected our experience as people of color. And so that's a perspective, it's a vignette of my experience with William Ellis Foy.
Yes, very good. Now, you transitioned from the pastorate to become the editor of Message. And for our viewers, that's the oldest continual running Black Christian magazine. So you became editor of Message around 1985, 1986. And obviously in that position, you were writing more, but you were also doing more speaking and traveling. I'm saying on a national basis. So this is the first piece I can find of you speaking on Foy to an audience, and this is 1984 at the Oakwood College Fall Week of Prayer. And it says that each day Baker was swept with invitations to speak to different classes about his new book on the life and ministry of William Foy. Now that book was pending, it was forthcoming. It would come about 2-3 years later.
That's correct.
So you started speaking on this, and this is a really important point about doing public history. Can you speak about the importance of the historian speaking, engaging with the people, and making history palatable and available?
Well, that's a powerful point that you're questioning here. It's one thing to have your internal thought history of something. I think most historians, they begin in their mind somewhere. They begin to question and query, and it's all internal. And then it goes from the internal to the external. You begin to buttress this with your writings and your research in a lot of different areas. That's more deliberate and planned. The internal part is what the synergy that's inside of you. The external part is when you actually go out and begin to search and do things that feed your internal thought one way or the other. And this is all a very, very process that has tension with it. Sometimes what you find outside agrees with what you know, and sometimes it doesn't agree. Sometimes it creates, conflict inside of you. You wonder, should I go ahead with it? Should I stop it? You know, is this something that's worthwhile? Maybe nobody cares about it. Why is it important? You know, these internal, external things. But your point, your question, though, about the public side of the research is so crucial. When you begin to tell people about the internal, the external, then it takes on a life of its own. People then begin to either validate or to invalidate, whatever way you want to look at it. Then you have to go back to your internal and external. Was it really correct? Does it stand the scrutiny of the public? But the public side is so crucial. And so my speaking and sharing and the affirmation questions that I received was very important between the time of doing the research and the actual book that was presented, that was actually made later. So yeah, I did lectures and I did the Week of Prayer Escape Routes at Oakwood. But it was really interesting that even though I did the Week of Prayer every night, people wanted to hear about Foy, man. They wanted to hear about William Foy. I mean, it was like a breakthrough with people of color. Hey, you mean really the one man that we know in the early history of the church wasn't in fact a reject, or he didn't reject the message, but he did it right? I mean, this was good news. This was a breakthrough. And I found that people like Jacob Justice, when I saw the historians at Oakwood, the committee I was working with, you know, Cleveland and Brooks, and these people really were helpful to me because they gave me affirmation. They said like, go boy, you know, you go man, you do what you're doing. And so it caught on. And so I believe, Ben, that this gave us a new platform as people of color to have ownership into the church. Because part of my schnick was that I was going from place to place was to position it that we have a part in this church. We have a part in the early part of the Seventh Adventist Church, not simply an afterthought. And, you know, we later the Congress came back in after, you know, 1865 and, you know, the freeing of the slaves and so forth. But we had a key part in the foundational aspects of the church. Back in the Millerite movement, in the early Advent, and the forming of the church in 1863, and all of this. And so this was a great piece, and I want to give a shout out to the other historians that preceded me. But here was one pivotal figure, William Foy, and then it was researched out in a book that was published by no less than the Review and Herald itself, the major flagship publishing house of the church, and then it was made public, and then you had a person who was actually spreading it. So yeah, this public side was crucial, and then from there, people took it and ran with it on their own. People wrote articles, people picked it up, you know, and they've taken different areas. And I even said in this book that we have, we're looking at right here, that this was just the first step. There were going to be other historians like yourself, and you've done some great work in it, and even the SD Encyclopedia piece that you wrote on William Foy, to me, takes it to another level. I took it to the level that I did, and now we need other historians to take it from this point and to further develop it and make it and take it where history will allow it to go. So yeah, the public part is crucial, and now it's a part of our psyche as African Americans in the Seventh Adventist Church and even outside of the church. And who knows where we'll go from here. But let me say one further point on that public aspect. The public aspect plays a good role in the affirmation or in the retardation of so to speak, research and what comes out of it. And fortunately, in my case here, it was affirmation. But it also does something more. It plants the seeds for other things, for other research projects, for people to take it in various directions. But even beyond that, it says to us that we have a role. And now I hope that young women and young men, you know, across the face of the planet, around the world, whatever your background is, you will take hope in this and say, look, God used this person, God can use me. And not simply use me as maybe even a public figure, but why not use me as a historian? To tell my story, to write my articles and to put my things out there and let my thoughts influence other people.
Yes, and you know that when you were touring and talking about Foy, that when the book came out, it reached a different level. Because when there is actually an entire book on this figure, and this sounds rather mundane, but there's a real book, or there's a book on that. And that's what people were actually saying. There's a book on Foy now that spotlights and highlights his life. And he lived, of course, past the 1845, 1846 date.
Up to 1893.
Yes, 1893. So if you can just say a word about this book, I believe it was a three-part series. It was a trio with The World of Ellen White and From 1888 to Apostasy by Gary Land and George Knight, respectively. So this was a part of a three-part 1888 centennial series. Mm-hmm. And so from its very beginning, it was placed in a prime position to be groundbreaking. And I would say that that's exactly what it was. I've called it a kind of a renaissance in Black Adventist studies because it just opened up so much. If you can imagine a Black man being faithful to the call before Ellen White was called, and you show in the book about how she would attend his lectures as a teenager in Portland, Maine. She would attend his lectures and she learned from him and she saw him being faithful to his prophetic calling in the midst of adverse and often antagonistic circumstances. And then you have a chapter that is comparing his visions with hers. And so there is a definite link there. And I can't stress how important something like that would be to Seventh-day Adventists. Not only just Black Seventh-day Adventists, but Seventh-day Adventists in general. So please just say a word more about this book and its reception and what it meant for you?
Well, I think you stated it well in terms of the dynamics around the book, and you have, you know, laid it out. It was almost like a, you know, aligning of the constellations in a sense. You know, you had a Black man of color at Message Magazine in the Review and Herald, a position of prominence and a position of some, you know, note, visibility. People knew me, they saw me, they knew I was in the pastorate, I had the pastoral background. And you're right, it came out with that trilogy of books. It was one of the trilogies, and it was a very important set, and people bought it. It was promoted widely by the Review and Herald. It sold many, many hundreds, if not thousands, of copies of that set. And it was endorsed by the church. And that, to me, was a key part of it. Now, let me go back after having said that. I want to stress this word providence. That's one of my foundational words in my life and my ministry. Our providence, God's guidance through common everyday events. And he works his will out through that. So I believe that this whole movement, the book, the research, the timing was providential. And I say it for three reasons. Number one, a word that I found to be very, very significant to me in this whole research study was the word initiative. The word initiative. Initiative means that we self-motivate to do something that we don't have to do. It's like we're moving in white space. There's no rules. There's no, nobody makes you do it. It's got to be your own energy and your own creativity that causes you to do it. And then you got to keep doing it and see it to its end. That's the initiative, moving the white space and accomplishing a purpose. So I had to take the initiative. And I had to do this thing from Andrews to the pastorate, to the research, leaving my pastorate, getting the support of my church to allow me to do this, finding money to support me in the research, and then the loneliness of doing it, the doubts that I had to deal with internally about doing it, you know, how would this be received? And then finally, I want to come back to, beside the word initiative, in initiative is the factor of consultation. And I can't stress that too much for people listening, that if I had taken this topic by myself and didn't have the backing of people and didn't stay in touch with consultation with people, I could have lost the moment. That the wider state could have said, I have nothing to do with that. But in fact, a Tim Poirier and others joined in with me, and we even had a joint obligation in getting genealogists, the Mormon Church, to help do the research on the roots of William Foy, which was a crucial part of it too. That was very crucial. So I consulted with the White Estate. I kept in touch with, you know, a good friend of mine and supporter was Neil Wilson, who was the president of the church, NAD, and then president later of the General Conference. The Black leadership, they were very much a part of this. The Black presidents, Oakwood College again, with the support group that I had there. So, and then I kept in touch, as you said, with the common people, just the folks who were in the pew listening to it, the average person listening, they were like, okay, we believe this. Or what about this? All my scores of presentations, they had questions, you know, what about this? And what about this right here? I heard this, and the articles would go out and people would react to it. And so I was able to get all of this prior to the actual publishing of the book. So the word initiative was crucial with the consultation. Second, the word is positioning. And this goes to providence as well. The initiative was providence. God gave me the push to do it, but also it was the positioning of a person of credibility who was writing it. I was at the Review and Herald. I was editor of Message Magazine. And so therefore that helped a lot and people were hearing it. And then it was embraced. So the positioning was so right. And then finally, I would say just the alignment, the alignment of events. When I said the lining of the constellations, I mean, what I mean more specifically is it all kind of worked together to make the story. Like you said, one of the trilogy and people were ready to hear further truth. A lot of people were doing things in the secular world, breakthroughs with Black history and people writing great works on it. It was, you know, it was in the post-civil rights era and people were now open to receiving truth for many, many decades. Really, for that matter, many scores of years, the Black story wasn't told, and white people often didn't do it, or if they did it, they did it incompletely. But then along comes Black people who are writing about Black people. We have to tell our own story. And that's just it. It hit me several times. And just, I would say, well, why haven't we heard this before? People said that. Finally, it hit me in the process of this. I said, why don't we tell our own story?
Yep.
Well, why are you waiting for people to tell our story? I mean, it's like, you know, okay, history left us out. Well, then we need to put ourselves in. We need to tell our own story. So I think, Dr. Ben, this is something that people listening can do. What is the story today? What is the story in this Black Lives Matter era, in this postmodern era, in this era of the Me Too movement and all of these things? What story do we have to tell that comes from our experience that we can position ourselves? Well, how can we take initiative? How can we position ourselves? How can we be aligned to tell our story for today? Because I think every age, every period needs its story. We need to hear what is the burden of this time. So that was then, you know, I think it's wonderful. I love to talk about it. It's a great thing, but I think this is now. And so I think the synoptic lesson we can take from this is, okay, it happened then, so that worked, but now we need to reintroduce the need for other writers to do what they need to do, like you're doing, like other young scholars are doing, to keep the story going. Keep on telling the story.
Good. Let's talk about your interest in Ellen White vis-a-vis Blacks. This is from 1983. And this has been a really important and enduring document, an enduring study that you did. Yes. Ellen White had a couple of statements that you covered, first on race wars and then the revival of slavery. And so there were questions surrounding these statements with maybe a bit of trepidation, definitely wonder, but maybe some trepidation about coming race wars and the revival of slavery. And this, I think, was your entree into Ellen White studies, which you've done a lot of work in, and we'll speak about your dissertation. Please talk about how you got involved in this and how this document came about.
Wow, this is a great document here. In fact, this particular monogram is on file even as we speak in the Ellen G. White Estate at the General Conference. So this is more of a manuscript version of it, but they actually have like a book cover and so forth with the White Estate. That people can go online to the White Estate and pull up there, and it's a free PDF if they want to download it. Well, this is an interesting one, Ben, and this ties in with this goes back to the William Foy story too, because when people knew that I was writing about William Foy and they saw that I had some notoriety as a writer and as a speaker on that, remember they had these unknown files or these files that they weren't releasing to the public. What did they call them? Z file, X files or something? There was these files that were not being revealed or released to the public, and people were very, very interested in them. And part of it had to do with her statements about race and Black people and some private correspondence. I actually understand why the White Estate and why the White State didn't reveal this during this period. I do, but many people questioned them and they felt there was these secret documents they weren't revealing. So the people during that period, Paul Gordon and who then was the director of the White Estate, said, listen, you know, we need to start addressing these issues. And he took a lot of these statements, one being the race wars that Ellen White promised would happen or said would happen. And they said, we've got to release these, but how do we release it? We don't just throw it out there with no explanation. So they said, we need someone to write some monographs of these short documents that kind of explain what it is, give a context for it, give a position that is reasoned, that is acceptable, and that we can release to the public. So they begin to look for that. And then they had heard about my work as the researcher, William Foy. The book wasn't written then, but they heard about it And so they called me and asked me, you know, would I be willing to do a paper that they would study and see if they wanted to release it, to release the statement with that document I wrote with it, this monogram. So I said, hey, listen, I'm willing to talk about it. And so I remember Paul Gordon himself flew to Dayton, Ohio, and came to visit me at our home there when I was again pastoring the Dayton Ethan Temple Church there. And we had a wonderful conversation. We talked for, you know, a couple hours about it. And he said, can you write this piece? You know, gave me time, gave me the challenge, told me what they were trying to do, and the rest is history. I took this as really being a calling. I mean, because I had the highest regard for Ellen G. White and her writings. I knew she was inspired. Her ministry or her writings were a secret of the success of my pastoral ministry. Hmm. Even, of course, as again, with William Foy, it was her writings that, or her statements that helped her clarify it. So I felt very indebted to her, and I have a great deal of respect for her writings and the prophetic calling on her life. So when I wrote this piece, it was a challenge because I didn't know the answer. I didn't know when Ellen White said there would be race wars, was it past, was it present, or was it future? And so I really approached it as a true historian, asking myself, what is truth and where will truth lead me? I mean, that's really what the question was that I was dealing with. And again, the document speaks for itself. As I got into it, I did this, as you see there, the interview setting when she talked with Doris Robinson in 1906, and she made the statement she did. Then I looked at the historical and the sociological setting around the time she made it. I saw the statements. I went back and did the research about what was happening then. And all of her references, I studied those out in context. And then I began to get a gestalt. They began to fall together in my thinking what she was talking about. In fact, there had been race wars. And so she was speaking from a position of race wars have happened true, and there were racial tensions, even as you know, as she was speaking in 1906. And then yet around 1915, 1920, there were other racial explosions that happened. This is in the Reconstruction period and, you know, the beginning of the Jim Crow period and all that. That time there were some serious tensions. I mean, lynchings and race wars in cities across the U.S. in different parts, some more than others. And
in
so-
In particular, you mentioned the Tulsa Oklahoma riot,
which was the
most egregious and atrocious.
Right. And you studied about that in yourself, and you've done a lot of writing on these things too. And you've even done some fascinating stuff at St. Louis. And I'm hoping that you can even make more prominent, because she talks about that in her 1891 message, you know, about, she talked about the racial unrest that was in the country that would come. And so these are things that have yet to even be brought up more, Ben. And I hope you and other writers, other scholars can do more in that. But anyway, back to this. So things happened in the years ahead of her, 1915, 1920, thereabouts in that period. Well, but then the neat way to do it was the temptation. I'll put it that way. The historical temptation when I was writing was summarize it with that. Just that's it. Okay, it happened. And she predicted once what happened, and it happened as she was passing off the scene and a little after that. But was that all? Was that all she was saying? No. As you study her writings more, she intimated, and as Ellen White knew how to do so well, she had the ability of dual applications. It happened then, but her writings leave the door open for the future resurgence of these issues as well. And that's what hit me. That's what hit me in this book. I said, I cannot in good conscience, even though a lot of folks would have been happy to say, okay, it happened, it's behind us, and that's it. No, there was more. And she said there would be more issues. And then she talked about in her other writings about how the race question was a problem that she feared would be an issue until Jesus comes.
Yes.
So the race wars issue happened, it was happening, and it happened shortly in or a little after her time, but it was yet to happen again. And she even ties it in, and you read the document, that even up to the time of Christ's coming. And I'll tell you the truth, Ben, for years in my ministry, I said, is this going to really ever happen? I mean, I knew the civil rights, and I knew, you know, things were getting better. You know, we had breakthroughs, and we had the Voting Rights Act. You know, we had even breakthrough for women. And then we had these other things in society, and even in the church had made some incremental steps as well to deal with the race issue within the church. So I thought things were getting better. And then even in my current time with Barack Obama, come on, you know, we never thought that would happen 4 years ever.
Dr. Baker, real quick. We may have been living in Los Angeles during the Rodney King riots. And so that was a major flare up. So along there were flare ups.
There were flare ups, but I think that's true. That's true. I want to say along with that though, I always felt when I saw these things happening, I thought they were temporary flare ups. I thought we had passed it. And I thought it was more on the progressive road to getting better. These were, you know, from the civil rights to, you know, the issue comes up and then we have to deal with these issues and then we build on that and go up higher. And then I guess the highest was Barack Obama for his first 4 years.
Yeah.
I said to myself, I said, listen, well, 4 years is something, but 4 years, a person could be president 4 years, but you got to be president twice to really get the full endorsement, the affirmation of the American public. When he became president twice, all two terms, I said, this is it, man. I mean, we've got it. Whatever we do now is, you know, we're moving on up. And then lo and behold, what we have seen in this last year or two. I mean, this Ellen White statement about race wars and this issue about being a problem until Jesus comes like never before. It's almost like I could take this piece now and kind of do a post article on it or another writing on it about how it's true and how it now speaks to us with fresh meaning. So what does it say? I mean, the end of it, I guess I could summarize my comments by saying that the document stands, but more than the document standing, her words are prophetic and her words speak to the nowness as well as even the future up until the time that Jesus comes. You know, as long as we wrestle with this sinful nature, the carnality that is within us, the flesh that we battle with, racism, classism, sexism, tribalism, all of these isms are something that we as a human family must be aware of. And let's face it, let's put aside the thought that, you know, one day we're just going to eradicate it forever. I don't think so. I think the good prophetess or the messenger of God has reminded us that we have to be ever vigilant with these items.
Good.
Oh.
Now, just a quick word, and this is a little bit of an interjection because I do want to talk about, well, maybe we can talk about your dissertation first, because your dissertation, Howard University, PhD communications was on the way Ellen White communicated about Black people.
Yeah.
So can you just share a word on that? Really, you've been talking about that, but this is your
Well, I mean, as you know, as a historian and as a writer of a voluminous dissertation yourself, I mean, it's hard to say to a person to say just a word on your dissertation. It's like, you know, who can say a word on their dissertation, but let me try. In the whole flow of events, you know, with the pastorate in Africa and William Foy and the race wars and the Message magazine. By this time, you know, I was definitely in the flow. I mean, this was where I lived, you know, with the whole issue of interpersonal relations between races, diversity. The church in its role in society, not only in society, but even in the household of faith, how we deal with one another and how we can model internally in the church what the world should be doing. These are things that I lived with. And so when I was editor of Message Magazine, and Neil Wilson was kind enough to sponsor me with getting my PhD with Howard University and the Review and Herald, Bud Otis during that time. They collaborated with the sponsorship. And so I took
and
it in.
Just a word, Neil Wilson was then the president of the General Conference of 70.
That's correct. That's correct. And he was in a perfect place to help. And this was following that, you know, that well-known fabled trip to Mount Kilimanjaro in 1988. And we went to the mountain, Ted Wilson, his father, Neil Wilson, Bill Johnson, myself, and two others, a doctor and a physical therapist. And so we went to the top of the mountain, and it was there that I shared the dream I had of getting a doctorate with Neil Wilson, and he embraced it. He said, let's work on it. Let's work on it. And then after that, we began to work on it and worked it out with the Review and Herald, and that the rest is history. I went to Howard University, and it was always my dream to have my doctorate before I was 40 years of age. And as God would have it, it happened just on time. Another word about dreams, how you can have dreams and goals in life and things aligned with you to do those if you really have some real initiative with it. Anyway, so in going to the Department of Human Communication Studies, along with Israel Leto, he was also in the program at the same time I was there. Okay, so human communication is a study, a love of mine, because it talks about communication and diversity with people. Now, remember, this goes along to with later, I went to Loma Linda, and they called me into administration to create the diversity program at Loma Linda University under Lynn Behrens. So this is all merging together here. But in this program, this human communication studies, we basically look at how do people and organizations communicate to accomplish their goals. That's basically it. And that's what the human communication studies is all about. How do we communicate, and what helps that communication, what hinders that communication, and how can we get it down to a science where we know that it can work, and how can we better make it work? And so that was the department. So when I went through that program 3 years, and going back and forth, this very, very rigorous period in my life, started doing that when I was a parent, when I was an editor, when I was still speaking in pastorate, it was difficult, but well worth it. When it came down to the time of dissertation, which really was like a year into the program, what was I going to talk about? Well, I had just gone through the flush of the William Foy experience. I just went through working with the regional conferences with Message Magazine, because they were the ones that primarily supported Message Magazine, and I was the editor of it for 7 years. I was led, I believe, through strong convictions to literally that title, The Dynamics of Communication in African-American Progress in the Seventh Adventist Church, Seventh Adventist Organization, a Historical Descriptive Analysis. And essentially what I was showing was how Ellen White's communications caused the entire church to become involved in the work with Black people in the South from 1890 to 1910. It was a 20-year, two-decade slice, but it was the most important slice of African-American history in Blacks in the Seventh Adventist Church. Because this was the time, you know, when they were beginning to go to the South, a few white persons, and then you had Edson White, and then you had the forming of the Southern Missionary Society, the SMS that Edson started, and then finally the Southern Union, and then you had people being green going into the General Conference, and on and
Oakwood.
On. Migration, what's that?
Oakwood.
Yeah, Oakwood. You had the mission schools in the South with Edson White, you had the Morning Star, you know, had all these things. So this was a dynamic period. So my point was, what did Ellen White do, and how was she able to motivate this somewhat young fledgling organization still to become involved in the work with Black people in the South? And I showed through a historical descriptive analysis how she was able to use communication, even though she didn't know all the techniques, and so forth, how she's able to use it to position and to motivate and to initiate and to cause the church to move and to do something when they were very reluctant, at least initially, to do it. And so that's what my dissertation is about. I did many charts and studies. I did some interviews with people. I took her statements. What I would do is I take these statements she made in context, historically time dated, and then I would show the linkages between that and the events that followed, like for example, Oakwood, or like people going to the South, or like the hospital medical work in the South, or like a variety of things. They're all in my dissertation. And then I showed how she made statements, how they happened, and was there a correlation between what she said and what actually resulted. Then I did some objective analysis with this. I got some objective people to look at that and see if they saw objectively links between what she said and what actually happened. And it was very successful because we saw the real connection, we saw the real link. We saw that Ellen White was able to use communication techniques, even though she didn't know them according to what I was studying at Howard and what the literature was saying, and to get the church to move. And in fact, I even was so enthused about what she did. My theory is still, that the same things can happen all around the world in unentered areas, that they could use similar techniques that Ellen White did, and we could get work to go in other parts. I remember I shared it with some different division presidents during that time and said, this is some literature you might want to look at for your own field and moving into the unentered areas. Mm-hmm. And to this day, I think they're true, and thus the philosophy behind the dissertation. Last thing I'll say was this. I had an instructor in Howard, one of my major instructors, who when I shared the philosophy of this, of Ellen White and her impact in Seventh Adventist Church, she was a little leery and said, I don't want this to be, Delbert, I don't want this to be you just simply talking about your church. And I was able to convince her that what I was doing was objective enough to say, it's not about my church, but did it work? Let's don't talk about whatever the denomination. And I was happy to see that she became a believer in the study, and she became one of the strong supporters of my dissertation. And one of the things I told her that, and I told the people in my cohort, in my doctoral program, that I believe in spiritual intervention. We formed a little consortium of scholars who had a little group there, and we went to help organizations in the Washington area with what we call these interventions, communication interventions, nothing to do with spirituality. And so we do it free. It was part of our practicum, with our communication degree. Well, I introduced to them that in spite of all these technical, interpersonal, organizational, conflictual interventions that we had developed and we could offer organizations, there was also one called spiritual intervention. And they kind of said, come on, man. I'm saying, no, there is an initiative with prayer and Bible study and using Bible principles that work with organizations. I said, you don't even have to totally endorse a Daniel model or an Esther model. They do work. And there was reasonable acceptance to it. If a person was a Christian, they had more of a leaning to it if they weren't a Christian. Nevertheless, but I, since that dissertation time, used that spiritual SI, the spiritual or spiritual intervention model in all the organizations where I've been, and I've seen it work. So not only did Ellen White's communication techniques say a lot, but also we see that the spirituality, the providential part of God working with organizations to accomplish his will is a viable, strong construct that people can use.
Yes, that's a lot. And I think at the very base of this, perhaps a foundation, is that she cared.
Yes.
That's where her heart was, because as you know, I recently did a compilation of all of her statements on Black people, and it's about 1,500 pages.
Wow.
And so she had that burden, and perhaps all good initiatives start with that.
You know, and I think Dr. Ben, I mean, you have done that that huge work, and I believe it's on your website on Black SD History. People can go to that and check out this huge compilation. I think scholars can go to that and do their own work. I mean, now that you put it together in the way that you have, which is a masterful piece, they can go do their own study and go in all kind of different directions. But let me say a word about that when you said about she cared. I love Ellen White. I just, she is one of my favorite sheroes. I mean, she to me has done more for this church than any other person I can ever imagine. I know she's a co-founder and I know all the history with that, but I'm saying beyond that, her writings have been so seminal and so pivotal to me in my ministry and in all good things that have happened in the church, okay? I don't see her more than, she's not some fabled person that was perfect, no. But I see her clearly as a true messenger in so to speak, work clothes and that we can relate to, that get God used. But one of the reasons why I so appreciate it is just what you said. Ellen White had a particular love for Black people and for anyone who was oppressed. So I don't want to make a full stop just after Black people. I mean, she was for women, believe it or not. I mean, people, you know, can use her in different ways about the ordination issue in the church, and they have different ways of approaching her. She was for people who were marginalized or ostracized in the church. She was for children. She was for people who were physically challenged. She was for the people who were challenged with age. She was for the people who were mentally challenged. So she was a champion of the oppressed. She was a champion of the oppressed. And so my dissertation and even the tying in with William Foy and other things only was one aspect of her multidimensional concern for the oppressed people or the marginalized people. So she is an incredible person. And I don't think we have exhausted that aspect of her. I mean, there are many more books or articles or whatever that scholars and people of interest in these areas can go into and showing how Ellen White was very much for that. And in this area of, you know, there's a debate going on right now in the church about, you know, how much do you get involved? Okay, what's social activism? You mentioned that people get a little nervous. Ellen White was not nervous, man. We don't have to refer to the fugitive slave comment, her comments about that to make the point. She lived Micah 6:8. Now she lived it. She was kind and she was merciful and she was about justice and she had a sense of humility. She lived that, and that's what we ought to do. And I think if we better understood Ellen White, we'd be less antsy about how to look at the issues today. We wouldn't be so hesitant and confused. Oh, what should we do? Should we get involved in this or should we not? You know, whatever. And I know it's kind of a sensitive subject to people, but Ellen White was clear on it. And so I want to end where I began with this little line, your line, she cared, Ellen White cared.
Yes, yes. All right. I want to talk about telling the story.
Wow.
And this, just to say a word about this document, this is a compilation that Dr. Baker did in 1996, and it was published, as it says, in cooperation with the Black Caucus of Seventh-day Adventist Administrators, and it was printed at Loma Linda, where Dr. Baker was at the time. And this, let me say exactly what this means to Black Adventist historiography. It took previous disparate, scattered, really archival and original documents, and even published pieces. This is before the advent of the internet, really. And it put it all together, put them all together in one book. It's about 600 pages. And to this day, I know me and others go to this book and are amazed at what's in there. It has really the essential documents of Black Adventist history. And so this is also one of those documents in which you can go and just study for yourself. Primary sources, archival sources, written sources, narratives, first person accounts, oral histories. And this telling the story has really been online since the advent of the internet age. The General Conference Archives has had it up. Other places have had it up. So it's also available. It's also had a long life online. But just the scope of it and the documents compiled is extraordinary. And this is a highly referenced work when it comes to Black Adventist history. I'm talking in the church and outside of the church. So if you can please speak on how you thought of this, how you did this, what inspired it, all of that good stuff.
Okay, well, you have given a very good introduction of it. And this is a love of mine. I mean, I love this book. It's almost like I want to take it and hug it. You know, I mean, it does, as you said, it has so much in it. Well, I will say this, that if I had the Black SD history website that you started, if that was in existence, I wouldn't have done this book. There would have been no need to do this book, because now your website, as far as I'm concerned, has this plus scores, hundreds of other items that people can go to and find what they need. And that was the motive for this book, Ben. That was really it. I wanted to put in one place the documents that people needed to do good study, well-balanced, full-orbed study on Black history, because it wasn't there before. I had a little bit here, you know, different writers, Singleton and Jacobs and Reynolds and even Peters and Peterson, and then the our files and, you know, Charles Kinney, all these different people had little pieces here and there and parts there. Ellen White made her statements and other people, but it was not together. And one of the motives in my entire ministry, and surely the historical aspect of it, was to be an educator and a facilitator of thought and research. That's one of my drives. Some people call it teach the world. I don't know if I would refer to it that way, but I do have a love to share and teach. I mean, throughout my ministry, everything from PowerPoints to study sheets back when I was in the pastorate, to documents, to articles, whatever I've written, it's been out for the public. People can have it, they can use it, they can do whatever they want to with it. So during the period of pre-Foy, Foy, and post-Foy, and especially at my time at Loma Linda, this was when we're dealing with diversity, I was doing all these lectures. And every time I'd go to these lectures, people would say, Dr. Baker, can I have that article? Can I have this piece right here? Can I have this? Can I have that? Especially with Foy. And then I'd say, okay, I'd go back and I'd have to kind of send it back to them. And I try to, you know, get the information out to them. And it just dawned on me, I said, with the initiative and with motivation, I said, how can I facilitate people having it themselves? And so that's when I became the very arduous, a difficult, painstaking task of pulling all this information together. It took me months to do this. This was not a quick job. I mean, I would do it. And then I had a small committee. I got some regional leaders, and I got some Black leaders, white leaders, and we got together, and I had a wonderful staff at Loma Linda University when I was administration there and teaching. So we began to pull together, and we began to pull together, and then I would do it, broke it up in sections, got the different documents, then I'd send them out and ask people, hey, listen, can you see, am I missing anything? And, you know, one of my good friends was Singleton, and I would talk with him and Dudley, Charles Dudley and George Earl and these people. And these guys knew the stuff. They knew it, but it was not in one place. That was it. So that and my chance for research, historical research, and even with Foy, what allowed me to put it all together. And I said, if I could just make this thing, so my goal was to make this so that people couldn't do without it. You know, that they just had to have this book. We made about 2 or 3 printings of it. And every time we do it, we sell it out, and we try to make it very inexpensive. And so it caught on. And then later, like you said, the archives of the General Conference, the White Estate, the regional offices, they all wanted permission to put it online. And I let them put it online free. And of course, it's on your website as well. Your website now is the best one to do it, the best place to get all these documents, because you not only have this one, but you have so many others there as well. So yeah, that's the thing there. And of course, it tied right in with my dissertation. Now that I had finished the dissertation and I had done it right before I went to Loma Linda, I finished my dissertation in 92, as you know, and then I went to Loma Linda from 92 to 94. I don't know if people know this, but right in between when I was leaving Message Magazine, I actually had accepted a call and I became the first Black associate in the LNG White Estate for about 10 months. And I guess that's why people really don't know it, because it's such a short period of time. It was for 10 months. And right before, even though I had bought a house in the Washington area and had accepted responsibility, I went to Loma Linda to take that position there, administration with diversity, and to teach there, because I thought that was a way to best use my recently acquired PhD. So why am I saying this? I'm simply saying this to say that during this period, this book was my way of saying, here, everyone, here's the information. You take it, you make the articles that you need to do and kind of go from this point.
Can you say a word on this slide? Because I know that this is one thing that you treasured, that you formulated.
Ben, you have that one. You do have that one. That is one of my areas of great interest. When I was working on my, really the tail end of Foy and working on my dissertation, I developed a lot of locked in views on Ellen White's linkages with the people of color. And one was, you know, her identity with them, or like you said, she cared, her identity with them. You know, they were in her will, she gave money during her life. She was a strong supporter of, you know, Oakwood College. Her son, her oldest living son, you know, went to the South after his reconversion. He went to the South to work. Her other son, Willie, who traveled with her and basically was her manager, he and she went to Oakwood often for the board meetings. She would go there and speak to the students on the Oakwood campus. I mean, she was the one that firmed the GC leadership, get that school, don't let that moment pass. And so she went there, and so she was tied in with it. Well, but it was even more than that. I mean, when Epson was in the South, he found great affinity between Adventist teachings and the freed slaves. Why? And he found that when he went up and down the Mississippi River, and he took the Morning Star from one place to the other, he creatively used it. He always wanted to be a ship captain. He always was interested in sailing and boats and everything like that. And so when he was converted, and then he saw the need there in the South, and his mother encouraged him, and he was able to finally do his love to be a captain and to have a ship and to do evangelism. So that was a creative thing of the Morning Star concept. So he'd go up and down the Yazoo River, up and down there, and he would speak to Black people and start these what they call holy schools, that's H-O-L-Y, or mission schools. And they were feeders. He did some 35, 40 plus of them in the South. And they were feeders to Oakwood Industrial School that started in 1896. So when he would do it, they would be trained well enough, and then they'd send them to Oakwood. And he even would accompany some of the Black folks to Oakwood. He'd meet his mother there from time to time, his mother and his brother Willie there. So they were all tied up in Oakwood and Black people. He started on the Morning Star. He started the health ministries. He started gospel primers. He would, for his textbook, were books that he and Emma, his wife, wrote, and Palmer, his associate, wrote. And they would use these on the Morning Star to train Black people who would come there. Well, the question is, why didn't he stay there and create a school and stay there? Well, they were killing white folks who went to the South helping Black people. They would lynch them too. They would murder them, they would burn them out. And the many harrowing stories that Ron Grable tells in his Mission to Black America, about how he had to run for his life. So So that was it. Okay, so all that's to say this. Okay, he found and he documented the fact that Black people liked Adventism. When I say like, that's a weak word. They were drawn to Adventism. They found it to be very appealing. Why? Because the teachings that Adventism espoused were what the slaves needed. Ellen White said in her writing, she said, as surely as God delivered the Jews, the Israelites out of Egypt, so he delivered Black people out of slavery. And she says, and he wants to teach them further. Get that, he wants to teach them further. So that means in the early 1860s, prior to the Civil War in 1865, God was like freeing the Black people, but he didn't just simply want to free them. He wanted to free them and teach them and train them with the truths that around the same time in 1863, when the church officially started, were in place to give them what they needed to be truly regenerated, free persons. And that was the message of Adventism. And clearly we know Adventism was for the whole world, but in particular, this was a message that would help these people. And you got it right there before you, the benefits. You know, I love this, a slavery destroyed self-esteem, but then you got the Bible, the scriptures, separated family, Christ provided friends and security. There was the manipulated spiritual desires, salvation pulled it all together, made them free people in Christ, slavery abused, stewardship freed or released or empowered. Slavery discouraged values, standards. We believe a lot in standard Adventism. Slavery was all about revenge. And yet the sanctuary showed that there was a better day when God would make it right. Black people didn't have to hate white people. And that's one of the blessings of history, that Black people never really have hated white people. And if they had turned on them like they could, we would have had a bloodbath on both sides, but it didn't happen. So slavery was about labor. The Sabbath gave them rest. Slavery was about faith, a ridiculed faith, and spirit of prophecy talked about God's providence and his protection, and just you could trust him. Slavery sponsored spiritualism. And then of course, the state of the dead teaching showed us how the truth about what happens after death. And then finally slavery cultivated hopelessness, and the second coming said there's deliverance. So thank you, I haven't seen that in years. I mean, that's kind of a summary. I talked about that a bit in my dissertation, as well as in telling the story in other places. But yeah, but let me just end by saying this, that even though I say that for slavery, I would argue that for people, for Hispanics, Latinos, Asians, you know, Africans, Russians, you know, you name it, Adventism offers the stuff that they need. And if we can embrace this, it is the message of liberation for all people, and especially or including oppressed people.
Good, good. What advice would you give to, first of all, Black Adventist historians or those who do Black Adventist history, and for those who aspire to?
Well, this particular article you have there, that's in Rock's compilation. He wrote a book and asked me to write that piece there. I was privileged to write it. And in there, I really answered in depth the question you just asked on how people can view Ellen White and her influence on Black Seventh-day Adventists and other oppressed groups. So I think that's a kind of a summary. We could use this as a model, so to speak, on how people who are oppressed and have needs can profit from the spirit of prophecy. And this is just this particular article there helps to articulate that. And I think others can do a variety of things in terms of helping people. I think right now in the Black Lives Matter movement or the Me Too movement, there's so many people who have been abused and disadvantaged. And I don't think we say enough about it. I think that the Adventist Church has a wider ministry, if they choose to accept it, to speak more in ways that are compatible with our values, on how the gospel is liberating, empowering, and it can change society. Ultimately, we know that the final solution is in the second coming of Jesus Christ, but there's much that can happen before then.
Thank you so much, Dr. Baker. This is good stuff for not only aspiring historians and those that do Black Adventist history, but just everyone, Adventists, anyone in general. Thank you for sharing your journey with us. I've learned a lot, and I'm sure others will as well.
Well, thank you for the opportunity, and may God bless all of our listeners, that they may be motivated to do great things for Christ.